Okay, I think we can get started. Good evening. I'm very honored to be able to introduce Jrg Conzett for tonight's lecture. Just to give a little bit of a background of Jrg Conzett. I first had heard about Jrg when I was teaching in Switzerland in the mid-90s, and I never really met him, but there was always his presence known in some way or other. He had a bit of mythical status as a kind of guru for engineering in the mountains. And there was always a sense when I was working in the office of Miley Pater that if there was ever any question or problem or need for an innovative solution to an engineering problem, it was always to consider what Jrg would say. What's probably most amazing about Jrg Conzett is his relishing in problem solving. There's an infectious kind of desire, and you can really read it in his eyes. And in many ways, he goes beyond just the solving of the problem, but actually helps to redefine the problem of an engineering question. In many ways, during the process of an architect speaking together with Jrg, I think one finds that you learn more about engineering when you leave. As Jrg is also a great teacher, I've had an experience with a group of my students. We went down to his office and to get a tour, and we ended up being there for quite a number of hours learning about the different projects in the office, and the enthusiasm of his presenting the various options for a bridge was quite amazing, with such dedication. And since then, I've also sent other students to him, and he's always very welcoming of them as they have gone. I mean, one student of mine last year flew down especially to Switzerland to meet with him and to speak about a timber bridge that he was doing, and ended up being there for probably close to 3 hours. So he's not just a good teacher, he's also has had such an amazing impact on design, and I would argue, and probably most people in this room would argue, that he's probably one of the most important structural engineers in Switzerland. And I see this not only in the sense of his inherent ability to make things look simple, or difficult things simple, which is often more difficult than what it appears. His work comprises largely of elemental components that have a desire for not a structural expression, but more importantly for a spatial and a material expression. There are two points to this. On the one hand, the structure seems to give back a greater sense of power of the expression of the material. And on the other hand, through his innovation, he's able to enable greater spatial innovation. Jrg Conzett studied architecture and engineering at the EPF in Lausanne and the ETH in Zurich from 1976 to 1980. After that, he worked for 6 years with Peter Zumthor in Haldenstein. And following this very important and defining period, he then began his own practice together with Gianfranco Bronzini Gartmann, and has had an office now and with about 20 or so people. And his innovation is very much focused on bridges in wood, steel, and concrete, but of course he's also done other projects that include the Expo Pavilion in Hanover by Peter Zumthor. This lecture is also tied together with an excellent new publication of the AA that came out in June of this year, and I'd like to also acknowledge the various people that have contributed to that. First of all, Pro Helvetia and the Canton of Graubünden for sponsoring the book. the Swiss Ministry of Foreign Affairs, who's also sponsored the book launch and this lecture. And also, very importantly, is Moisen Mostafavi, who's initiated this project and has brought Jurg into the school. There was also a lecture in the mid-90s, or an exhibition. And also, importantly, Pamela Johnson for editorial work, and also Nadine Rinder for the design. So I'd like to just give a warm welcome to Jrg Conzett. Thank you.
Good evening. First, I want to thank the AA for the invitation. It is a very special moment for me to see the book finished, selling, and those who were involved with it know how it ran out of schedule. It was incredible, the patience the AA had with me, but I can also say that for me, working on that publication was something that had an effect back on the way of thinking and on the way of working. So certain projects of the last years would not have been turned out as they do without this book, and I think this is a reason to be very thankful to this great collaboration, especially thanks to Pamela Johnson. I would like to mention some backgrounds of the book, but first I just give you an idea of who we are in the office. As you see, we are a partnership. We are a long-time partnership with an intense collaboration, so I always use the form of saying we decided, we discussed. It's a common work which has an almost unchanged staff of people for the last 10 years. I need to point. So, we are situated in Chur. Chur is the capital town of the canton of Graubünden, which is the biggest canton of Switzerland. As you can imagine from this map, there is a strong north-south traffic, Germany, Austria to Italy. Of course, there is farming, small industries. This is Chur. Railway station, a fragment of a big project done by Peter Rice. This is where I live. This is where I work. And one strong thing that started in the 18th century was tourism. At first, some fearless monks climbing the mountains. And soon it became a common pleasure. And as you see, tourists need bridges, so we like to build bridges for tourists, but not only bridges in the Alps, we also like to build bridges for bikers in a town, road bridges of concrete, sometimes wooden bridges for roads, or even stone bridges. This is a new stone bridge for a village where they had a lot of stones. An important part of this bridge building work is the rehabilitation of existing bridges. Dealing with bridges is maybe half of the activity of our office. The other half is the collaboration with architects. An administration building in an urban setting, or a project I'm working on right now, a high-rise building. 40 meters, for me, it's enough. One special thing about this, some kind of a skeleton and a curtain wall, but the skeleton is outside and the curtain is inside. A wooden market hall in an old town. Or a barn in a remote alpine place. There is a special interest in the architecture of infrastructures, a highly cultivated theme in the first half of the 20th century. So we try to construct new retaining walls in a historical context. And this commitment goes till the careful detailing of a balustrade. So now, what is the common thing? What is the common denominator of all these things? What's the quality that interests me? I try to explain this with that diagram. On the left side, you see a list of all these restrictions, conditions, programs you have when you enter a project. And what is always very strong is when you find a concept that covers at one time all these different programs. And from this concept, emanate the subsequent decisions and precisions and realizations. So maybe the concept looks very simple, looks even modest. But if you have a lot of lines on this left side of the diagram, it is a strong thing. The more lines you can combine, the stronger it is. So I would like to illustrate tonight this diagram, first with some historic examples and the consequences of this diagram on design of structures. Then in the second part, I would like to deal with some, I call it tools, like absorbing, but also the aspect of moving, of so-called living structures. And then the essential thing of an engineer is structural optimization, but also there can be something like structural historicism. So it will need a certain patience from your side, maybe an hour or so. History. Once again, this diagram. Imagine the concept as a chemical process, as a melting together of different influences which cannot easily be reversed. Somebody said it's easier to be a prophet than a historian, because the prophet has to conclude from a cause to an effect. But it's difficult to conclude from an effect to different causes. And the stronger the concept is, the more causes you have. And there is the danger, especially when there are no written sources, that you underrate an existing building just by not knowing about all the different influences it covers. you reduce a concept to an unequivocal cause-effect line, then you can do a great injustice to a historic building. And to demonstrate that, I would like to mention Susenpass Road, which is the architecturally most ambitious alpine road in Switzerland. It links Canton Uri here on the east side to the Berner Oberland on the west side. The architect Walter Tschokke has written a thesis and a great book about the influences on that road. And he analyzes even the longitudinal profile. This is the east axis in the Uri canton, which shows like that north-south traffic tradition. So very linear, a very linear ascent. On the Bern side, it's much more picturesque. It reflects, even in the longitudinal profile, the tradition of tourism. On the east side, you feel this linear force. You are like driven to go directly on the top of it. You don't like to stop. And as soon as you cross the pass, you enter the west descent. And you see, for example, here, like the gradient varies, and when you drive yourself in a car, you experience different views just by changing gradients. And in fact, the road was very carefully planned, including viewpoints, special effects for its users, and in a way it reflects even a British tradition of the three-dimensionally curved line as the essence of beauty, which had its influence in the German road building of the 1930s, which again was very influential on Swiss road building. If you look at the Susenpass Road more closely, you find some ostinate elements, like these square guard stones along the road, but also the way the rock is treated with this overhang is a form that reappears again and gives its character to this piece of road. One special moment is the double tunnel, or should I say, tunnel with a hole in its vault. Again, this is a not documented influence, but you could say this kind of interrupted tunnel is like a classical pattern. Look at the painting of Hubert Robert, who spent a whole life by studying elongated galleries with interruptions. Looking at this, you easily come to Paddington Station by Eisenbart Brummel. Elongated galleries interrupted by the light, and each time I'm there, I'm fascinated by the effect that these simple eye beams in the flat part of your view form a closed vault and have a very bright impression if you look up vertically to this roof. So you can trace a relationship from Paddington Station to the Susan Pass Road, like one possible influence. But if you are not able to do so, then it can happen as it has unfortunately happened, then one half of the tunnel has been taken away. Nobody knows why. Probably some cracks there, and the local road supervisor decided the easiest way is to destroy the thing. And these are damages which are not repairable. In Graubünden, the Rhaetian Railway became famous for its very consequent use of stone viaducts. If we examine this detail, you can say, okay, that makes a lot of sense. You have the masonry here, you have a granite plate covering the top of the masonry, and under the joints of these granite plates, you have some cantilevering stones. That makes a lot of sense. Today, you have the problem, after 100 years, that these bridges have to be tightened. Water penetrates into the structure, and that they are too narrow for modern safety requirements. But again, if you look at this detail, you should not reduce it to the pragmatic reason. If you study the contemporary national romantic architecture, you realize that it fits exactly to that kind of fine ornament in contrast with huge masses and undivided surfaces. So exactly by these stones, by this detail, the viaduct becomes part of a more general architectural movement. And even in these details, the reminders of the scaffolding, you see the interest, the pre-functionalist interest in the craftsmanship, but at the same time, it doesn't mean that these works are crude. If you examine the pillar, after a certain while, you see that big stone here, and you find out there is another similar one here, and at the same level here. Why is this like that? Then you need the drawing. You see that the interior of these pillars was filled, like in Roman times, with a mixture of rough stone mortar, but every 10 meters there is a double layer of precisely sawn stones to keep the whole thing together. And this layer is discreetly marked outside by these cornerstones. And I think this is a discrete quality which shows care with which these viaducts have been built. So this work of waterproofing and enlargement is very complicated, because you cannot interrupt the train's traffic. It has to be made at night, and the logistics of these building sites are not an easy task. In central Switzerland, it can turn out like this. So the bridge is tightened and it's enlarged, and the water comes out here, and at the same time you have to say architecturally it's vandalism. It's destroying the quality, a very important quality of these bridges. And so I was asked as a consultant for the Rhaetian Railway to look for better solutions, and I can show you one example. So this was the viaduct before its reparation. You see, one problem is, for example, the conduct, electrical conducts, which just have no space inside the viaduct. And then, after a long discussion, where I insisted that these stones are very important, it turned out to a solution with a concrete trough for the ballast, with concrete cantilevers to cover these conducts, but maintaining the stones. Now, if you look at it like that, for an engineer, this is a very unusual thing to use structural elements which have obviously no functions. And I really touched some very deep feelings inside my colleagues to insist on such things, but with the help of the head of the Department for the Conservation of Monuments, it was possible to use this as a prototype here. Now it looks already better. But you have seen what is the alternative. If you try to maintain this honest quality of not using inefficient way, inefficient elements. And I think finally, as a result, it's much, much better than this kind of cutting and adding just a concrete top. It was like a happy accident that at the same time our office had the job to enlarge a road viaduct beside this railway viaduct. So what you see on the right side is also work from our office, where we seem to contradict what I just told, but here, this is a viaduct from a special time, from a great consistency over a whole region. Whereas on the right side, the viaduct used to be like that. A layer was added in the 19th century already, and what we did is adding another layer, which from the other side of the viaduct looks like this. So now there is a double width of the driving way on this bridge. Mm-hmm. It was clear that we had to use concrete to do that job, but you see how we tried to frame the arch by these slender prefabricated columns. So in the finished aspect, I think it's a valuable solution. It was easy to build and at the same time doesn't destroy the existing work. So to go on with this railway discussion, I was not totally satisfied with the concrete cantilevering. And another prototype was done this autumn, where you see prefabricated concrete elements, the old granite plates reused, added sidewards, and also, again, these cantilevering stones. So these are the prefabricated elements. And the final aspect looks like that. So a hard work to maintain a known aspect of a bridge. This is the type of a tripartite arch bridge, which is very common on this railway. It's like a leitmotif. Again, you can use that as some of these hidden influences. In such a touristical environment, it's maybe not accidental that you find the same motif in Versailles. It reappears on bigger viaducts. the three arches. It appears in railway buildings, even on different levels. And at one time, this motif appears in a retaining wall. And if you look at the situation, it's here. And this cannot be accidental, because this is the only part where the railway runs for a short time parallel to itself on the on both sides of the Albula River. So from here, you have an excellent view on the lower trace of the railway. And exactly there, this motif appears. I think this is obvious, that there is an intention behind that. And again, I think we have to find out such things to find a quality in these kind of infrastructures. Okay, for design of new bridges, an example for a overpass, maybe a daily job to build such a bridge. But when you look at this section, you find out that at the same time, you have dealt with the conducts, you have achieved a certain robustness, but also there is a certain elegance in the shape of this girder. And think again, it's the tripartite bridge, which is a common motif, as you have seen. Hans Hilfiker, who was not really a bridge builder, has very much influenced that way of thinking. Once he proposed a platform shelter for the Swiss Federal Railway, and he said, usually these shelters have too many legs. They are an obstacle for the users. Let's concentrate all the different functions in only three supports. One, two, three. So you have watches, you have indicators, you have telephones, you have water pipes. All these different things are combined in one element. And so destroying almost literally explains my diagram. When you have snow on only one half of the roof, there is a torsion effect, which is taken by this steel tube, and we transformed this principle in a wooden shelter, again with this huge wooden section for torsional effects. Hilfiker illustrated the different resistances of members to torsion to show how hollow boxes or tubes are the most adapted elements to that kind of solicitation. And once he made a proposal for a bridge, it's near the Gotthard Pass, a famous gorge, and he proposed in this climate, in this harsh climate, a tube of stainless steel fixed into a vertical granite rock, and beside the technical advantages against corrosion and so on, he mentioned that the brilliance of the mica in the granite would correspond very well to the brilliance of the stainless steel of his bridge. And it was later on that I found out that this design was at the same time done like the standardized Swiss kitchen from the 1950s with the stainless steel discovering. And again, we used Hilfiker's idea in the Punta Saranzuns with the stainless steel combined with local granite or gneiss steel plates. Of course, this is, like I said at the beginning, a background. We had good reasons to do that. There is a highway in the proximity which could have salt spray touching this bridge. So again, there have been different reasons to combine especially these two materials, but the Hilfiker influence is not the least important one. Some words about the tools, absorbing things. My father was a surveying engineer, and some time of his life he spent as a cartographer. And he was a student of Eduard Imhof, painting a map here. A map by Imhof where he explained that for the first time he could graduate the heights with colors in a satisfactory way. He was not searching for a realistic image of the landscape, but for colors that create the right feeling, the right sensation. Also, the light here is coming from the north, which in reality never is possible. But you need the light from the north to create the right sensation. Imhof also made expeditions in the 1930s to China, for example. Or he was a passionate painter of landscapes. He used to illustrate guides climbers. And he wrote some very interesting books. One of these is called Gelände and Karte, Terrain and Map. And again, how do you create the right sensation if you are in the scale 1 to 100,000? Still, you realize that this is a village. Maybe this is a different way of looking at things that structural engineers are used to. The structural engineer likes to show what happens, to show how it works. And the cartographer, he wants to create the right sensation. I think you agree all that on the left, we have two hills, and on the right, we have two excavations. Or it's interesting how we perceive height differences. You see the same 6 points from different standpoints. And especially the image on the right can show us that we have no level in our head. It could be a very harmless meadow in the beginning if we would not see reappear the terra in a far distance, which gives that scary effect on the right. And here Imhof writes that upwards, doesn't always mean upwards. And I used this image for the second Traversina crossing to calm down the emotions of the user of this bridge, having to descend a height difference of 22 meters by a stairway which is 60 meters long. So in this bridge, it was very important to take into consideration what the user experiences when he uses the bridge. So these end anchors of the two suspension ropes have not only a pragmatical dimension, but they also serve as hiding the structure from the view of the walker approaching this very special moment, because on the backside you have a vertical rock going down 70 meters. And even when you enter to the bridge, you don't see it. Only in the last two steps it appears, and it shows to you that it's not such an adventurous thing to go down. I mean, this is an experience you have in the mountains, that a trail seen from far away can look like impossible. And when you are closer, you only then you know what is really the case. It can be the opposite, of course. But here, in this bridge, it made sense not to show the construction too early to the user. One part of this activity called absorption is our concern with retaining walls, which I would like to mention for a few moments. Walls here in the Engadin as a protection against rock fall, where you don't know how old they are. They can be hundreds of years, or they can be 10 years. You don't see that. Similar thing near the Lake of Geneva. And our concern mainly with retaining wall in road construction. And we investigated for the road administration hundreds of walls, and we set out rules how to deal with that kind of walls. And I just can mention a few rough rules which prove each time to be very efficient. Especially here, you see these joints going through. Every meter, you have a through-going joint. You can use very irregular stone, but when you have these parallel joints, at once you have a certain order in the wall, which gives a good look, I think. Or the work of the architect Rino Tami in Ticino. The principle of parallel top of the wall to the roadway, which is only interrupted by short 30-degree pieces, clearly comes from building the stone. You have the stone layers, which more or less automatically lead you to forms parallel to the surface, but this is transferred to concrete here. Or also, this is a very nice example. The parallel lines in accordance with the formwork by the concrete. It's not something that you have to do like this, but it's like a question of style in engineering. A form that is part of one material is transferred to another because one thinks it has just to be like this. And sometimes I try to generalize such experiences, and I said, okay, let's say the top of a wall always has to be parallel to the traffic surface. So using this for shaping the abutment of a bridge, you say, okay, this form is in accordance to that principle, whereas here, this kind is something very different. And I think the upper example is the better one, I personally. Okay, living structures. The biggest stone building in the world used to be the Mole Antonelliana in Torino. Antonelli was its builder. It started to become a synagogue. It was later converted into an exhibition space. Finally, with its spire, it became about 160 meters high, I believe. It was built in the second half of the 19th century. And in fact, Antonelli developed a skeleton system of bricks many years prior to the Chicago frame. And the cupola is a highly sophisticated system of brick walls. Still, people in Turin think this is a building which was much more a challenge than the Eiffel Tower, because it was built, as they say, in a paleo-industrial desert, whereas Eiffel could calculate all his members. So in fact, there were some difficulties. You see the deformation very clearly. And already during the structure, during construction, continuously, the building had to be strengthened with metal ties, carefully detailed by Antonelli. But after the death of Antonelli, nobody just knew how it worked. And after a lot of discussion about its structural soundness, it was decided in the 30s to cover the structure with reinforced concrete to guarantee its safety. And I would like to read a short text by a man called Annibale Rigotti, who said, "It was beautiful, this enormous heap of interlaced sinews, covered by a thin fabric of bricks, supported by 20 slender shafts. These people who had seen it grow, engineers and masons, regularly inspected it with great care in search for tiny cracks. Many little seals mounted with small panes of glass indicated some motions, and it had these motions because it was vivid, vibrant, because it was breathing. All the cracks, distortions, dislocations didn't trouble, because one knew that they were not fatal. One knew that still many passers-by would raise their heads and admire it. Today it's a corpse. They had mummified it while it was still living, wincing. They tormented it only to preserve its costume." It's a very interesting text, because it may remind us to the big impact of the Industrial Revolution to replace the organic by the inorganic. And this affected also the idea of beauty. Beauty as related to the organic world, beauty, the paradise as a garden, the hell as a mine. Maybe we still have not really worked inside us this impact of the Industrial Revolution. So I have my own experience with that kind of living structures. Schoolhouse in Duvin at that place. Church, old school, new school. When we built that, John Caminada and I, 12 years before, it was completely new way of building modern structures. Of course, it's the traditional way. You build such a house, but nobody did that during the last 20 years because it was considered as anachronistic. This is Giacometti in front of his atelier in Stampa, and you see some of the problems you can have with that kind of construction. If you have two windows, the part between the windows is not fixed laterally, and it can buckle. So we decided to use one window per panel. So for us to use this traditional way of building was like a research experience. And what fascinated us in this building is maybe not only that kind of vernacular regionalism, but deeper, the idea of a building that is made with freshly sawn wood and which settles about 15 centimeters during the first years of use. This was something quite extraordinary. We continued this experience in another schoolhouse. This time, the structure is much more skeletal, as in Duvin. And there is also a multi-purpose hall, which didn't allow this concept of one opening per panel. So we had to stiffen the structure by vertical posts, which are like rigid elements, whereas the wall made of these logs is shrinking and sliding along these vertical stiffeners. The facade and the windows are fixed to the verticals. The interior wall is the massive wood. By doing so, we introduced some grooves, which at the beginning of the structure are open upside the window and closed underside, but during time, when the locks are drying, the interior walls come down and these joints are closing and the other joints are opening. So again, this principle throughout the whole building. So once again, a vivid structure. And finally, these experiences, this background, made possible the construction of the Swiss Pavilion in Hanover, in the year 2000. As we were really not sure about how valid are structural codes for such a special building, we very early passed to a full-scale model. And we had not a lot of discussion that this was too vivid. And so this full-scale model led to the introduction of these transversal stiffeners, which you see here. So by a sequence of different tests, we came to the final result, but again, these resorts could cover a shortening of 17 centimeters without losing their strength, but as the wood was freshly sawn in the beginning, the whole stack settled down during the 6 months of the exhibition by 24 centimeters, which meant that the movements had to be controlled weekly, and early in the morning, a group of people with a special equipment had to go and regulate these resorts. Maybe the engineer who went the most far with structural optimization was Sergio Musmeci in Italy. Here in the background is the load test of a bridge which he made. It's this bridge. It's always interesting. I met his son. And I tried to discuss with his son how much in this structure is personal. I said, no, nothing is personal. All is calculated in this structure. That's a very pure objective form, which I still cannot believe, but maybe it's true. I just don't know myself. So, for example, Musmeci studied the minimal amount of material to form a cantilever. That's this kind of form. He published a lot of work about this mathematical background of minimized forms. Once he did a collaboration with Adalberto Libera in the Palazzo della Regione in Trento. So in the foreground you see a building that rests on two piers spaced by 40 meters. Here again you see these legs. And the structure is the so-called spina centrale, central wall, going over the whole length. And the offices and the roof structure is fixed to that central girder. And I once had the possibility to study all the documents of that project. Again, this is not very clear, but I suppose that this is the drawing that made Libera, the architect, alone before contacting Musmeci. So you see the idea of the two posts, and then what follows is some kind of like a Vierendeel truss. Big openings, but also big walls in between. And I tried to analyze this system, and I found some difficulties in making it work. And then is this drawing made by Musmeci, which shows a possible flow of stresses into that central wall, which you can, that's my comparison, which you can derive by this, again, optimum form of stress flow in a wall of constant height. So finally, the form of these openings changed, and now the analysis is what I have done. You feel like streams of stresses between islands. You see a way of continuity which has transformed completely the first drawing from Libera by the influence of Musmeci. So this is the interior view. When we go back to this drawing, I was myself in a very similar situation when constructing the Otterplatz building in Chur, because the architect's drawing also at first had small windows placed one above the other, and it was then our decision to shift the openings so that the structure forms a kind of diamond truss, which is very efficient. But it's like the opposite of the reaction by Musmeci. This is rather a repetition of a truss element, whereas he comes to an overall structural flow, which reminds rather an arch construction inside the Otterplatz. Facade of this building. The truss form of the second Traversina footbridge also derived through a long time structural optimization to find a curve which gives a constant force in the main rope during an extreme snow load. So you can say in the detailing of the abutments is a lot of influence concerning the experience of the user, but the structure itself is a very deterministic approach to structural optimization. But nevertheless, we had to analyze the erection process by a rather simple or primitive model, because software we use in the office could not deal with such big deformations when you assemble these different elements. So these are two auxiliary piers temporarily placed there to make the movement of this element not too big. So in reality, it looked like that, prefabricated wooden elements. And as in every suspension bridge, during the erection process, it looks odd, and you hope intensely that finally the form would be correct. Okay, to end with structural historicism, you can for example, learn by Maillard a concrete structure. It is a little bit extravagant kink, which reflects the deviation force in this part. For the community hall of Frin, we decided to leave away this kink, because here we had a wooden structure for different snow loads. There are some reasons to modify this Maillard concept, but the influence is very obvious. We can learn from Grubenmann, carpenter from the 18th century, who at a certain point of his experience introduced arches in the inclined plane of the roof rafters to avoid these walls from a lateral shifting. The arch concentrates the load on these corner points where the masonry structure is more stiff. In this flat folded work of the gymnastic hall, he introduced these arches by post-tensioning cables. It's just a reversal of traction and compression, but the principle is exactly the same as the one that Grubenmann used. So by this concept, it was possible to avoid any tension element spanning transversely through this roof, under this roof, which also would have been very difficult by the asymmetric pattern of the roof. This is the south side. It was reasonable to make these windows bigger than on the north side, and so the light also can reflect better. And it was really a great job by the architects to avoid every element that could destroy this effect of this pure folded work. Even the first Traversina footbridge reflects the inclined stiffened planes, the arch, the inclined plane on both sides. Again, a development from these other experiences. And also the principle of structural overlay can be traced back to the pre-industrial thinking of the Grubenmann brothers. You have the arch bridge, two arches, but at the same time a third arch. Maybe this pillar doesn't work properly, then you are glad to have this relieving element. And Tom Peters, in his beautiful book Transitions in Engineering, explains that you can only understand this kind of structure by the idea of overlaying simple systems. So what could at first gaze look as a mess becomes understandable if you see it as a combination of elements. And even this picture, which could be like a modern truss, also can be interpreted as an overlay of smaller and bigger elements. And the very loved Royal Albert Bridge by Brunel still is the combination of an arch bridge and a suspension element. Also this idea of combining systems, even in 1859. And the first Traversina footbridge finally also has this three jawed substructure, which rests on only two points, so could swing laterally by the slightest wind, and is stabilized by a completely different structure, the two balustrade of the walkway. So substructure during assemblage by a helicopter, it had to be very light, completed and stiffened by the plate girder balustrade. Unfortunately, this bridge has been destroyed in 1999 by a rock fall. It was replaced by the second bridge, the long stairway. And I like to end this lecture with this image dedicated to a gone bridge. Thank you for your attention.
I'd like to open up to some questions and answers for Jurg. So.
Well, this is a very unusual approach. I mean, in comparison with what I know of engineering education in Britain, and I only know this through a colleague engineer who described in the schools an absence of any of the kinds of issues of looking at history. So I have to ask whether this way of making buildings is personally assembled by you, or whether there is a current tradition in Switzerland, in the EPFL, of teaching engineering in this way. Am I being clear?
I don't know it even myself. Okay. Right. I think there is a strong tradition, right, or there is just a need to deal with these existing structures, which creates, I think, curiosity of how they work and how they are thought. But as I also showed, you have at the same time the opposite movement, which tries to reduce the engineering profession, really reduce it to the mere pragmatic thing, who tries to make things as simple or simplified as possible, which also exists in our country and which is a strong agent to react against. Probably in reality you have both tendencies. It's not so that in education you have, in my opinion, enough emphasis on that research for a broad network of relationships. But I think also in the last years certain consciousness has started.
But I was surprised to find recently that, for example, engineering history is a subject in the work of Antoine Picon, for example, the French academic who now teaches in Harvard. And this is my ignorance as an architect of the culture of engineering. So, and Picon was approaching engineering from a very developed contemporary historical point of view. in ways that one could understand through the experience of history applied to architecture. So for me, that was a very interesting revelation of how engineering worked. And I do remember being asked when I was a very small architect to assist on the design of a bridge, and I was very surprised to find the bridge designer concerned with massing and tree formations. For me, this was a revelation as an architect. But this lecture was a revelation, if I might say. Thank you.
I would like to mention the work of David Billington, who started to research about Maillard's work in the 70s, when Maillard in Switzerland was not really a known person. The Saugina Tobel Bridge was discussed to destroy, to replace in the 70s, which is incredible today. But so it was an American professor who brought back the Swiss tradition to the Swiss people. And today these are national monuments, but the origin for that is very clear, that was Billington, who reintroduced that knowledge. Also cartography, Dufour, who made the first map of Switzerland, he worked about 40, 50 years on that project. And it runs exactly parallel to the political development of the Swiss Federal Union. And it's really touching to see the development of Dufour's map. So only in parts first, and then around 1850, the whole shape appears. And at that time, Switzerland is becoming to be a country with its symbol in its map. So I think in the 19th century, this unifying function of engineering works, very generally, was very strong. But I think after the 1960s, things changed a lot. There was a strong loss of interest in these aspects at that time. I studied in the 70s, and that was the reason. It was not very correct. I studied engineering, not architecture. But after my diploma, I went to the office of Zumthor as a practitioner for a short time, and then became a bit a longer period. But this was a reaction to that engineering education of the 70s.
Thank you. I'm interested in your thoughts on the nature of your collaboration with architects. You don't strike me as a sort of engineer that architects go to have their vision realized or confirmed. I feel that is very much a symbiotic process.
Yeah. I can add that mainly we work very locally. Like Jüngling Hagmann, this is a collaboration. It started in the office of Zumthor when I still was an employee there. So we know each other by 20 years. And so it's some kind of a very natural collaboration, where you have common interests, where you have traveled together to Finland or things like that. So you cannot really divide that in a very strict way. Maybe it's much clearer with Libera and Musmeci, to say Libera went so far and then Musmeci came. That's my interpretation. And for example, the Autoplatz building during the competition, I was not part of the group. All these things came afterwards. It was, we were well prepared by the architects themselves. So I would see it rather as a common experience, also with Zumthor. I joined him when the office were three people. And so it was like a day we went together for a certain time and we learned together some things.
But you also collaborated with Miley Petter in Zurich or with Mila Maranta in Basel, I mean the longer term collaborations.
Yeah.
And I remember Quintus Miller mentioning that your solution for the Volta School was something established during a 2-minute telephone conversation or something like this.
Not a little bit longer, but yeah, this was. I just gave them some very basic principles. That's
useful,
one possibility of collaboration, like these wall elements. That's not very difficult to understand if you have an interest in it. And so, as an engineer, you can give like a tool to an architect. But on the other hand, the Swiss Pavilion of Zumthor was almost ready when he showed it to me, the stacks of wood. Of course, all these details had to be established, but the basic idea was already there and just could made fruitful. So I think if you are a good architect, you have ideas which have maybe a hidden structural quality, and where the job is just to find out that and make it to fix that. So I think it needs a certain common way of interest and thinking. I can say this idea of the concept that covers a lot of things has to do with that way of work, which is maybe not the most spectacular way to work. That's not producing brands in every case, but it's just that search, like Hilfiger does through his whole life, to combine different levels of thinking and of influencing.
Thank you.
Hello, I was just curious to know about some current work or future work that you're working on now.
Okay, one work that is very intense is this railway rehabilitation thing, which goes on. And for me, this is absolutely important. I had more sleepless night because of this work than of the Zurich Stadium. Because at a certain moment you feel very alone. It's just one time that you say some things go wrong and let's discuss that. And that's a work that started 3 years ago. And it's a permanent discussion. So we meet every 2 months. Say, where can we do what? Where can we try out what? And maybe this is not something very spectacular to look at, but I think it's absolutely important. And I give a lot of time to that work. The other thing I'm just currently working is the high-rise building I showed at the beginning. I'm working on a bridge competition for a 450-meter long bridge over an artificial lake and some smaller things like that. So it goes on as usual.